Welcome to Ghazali. Today we have with us Naman Ahuja. Dr. Naman Ahuja is an associate professor of ancient Indian history in Jawaharlal Nehru University in Delhi. He is an authority on ancient Indian art, architecture. Recently, he curated one of the best exhibitions I have ever seen at a national museum. It was called A Sacred Body in Indian Art. He had about 350 objects, sculptures of body depicted in Indian art, and they're so well displayed. I was actually proud that in India we have such an exhibition. So we have here Dr. Naman Ahuja. Naman, let's start with, why is this study of ancient art important?
Well, thank you for having me here, firstly. It's nice to have this conversation. You know, the study of ancient art is, for me, it's like asking a question, why do we need a library? Mm-hmm. Why do you need memory?
Yeah.
How does memory influence what you do today? Mm-hmm. There's so many things we seem to do in contemporary art or in the contemporary world, and we seem to think that these are particular innovations of our times or problems of our times. Mm-hmm. We seem to think that we are going to have to work very hard at finding a solution for our problems these days. But we don't realize that very often the same situation has been encountered previously, and some fantastic solutions have been found. Mm-hmm. Very innovative solutions to extremely complex situations are available to us, both in terms of society as well as in terms of artistic mm-hmm. responses. Mm-hmm. For me, an ancient artwork doesn't just exist as a work of art mm-hmm. only. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, primarily, it is an object of beauty. It is something which mm-hmm. is inspiring. Mm-hmm. But that quality of making it something inspiring is as much about knowing about your, how well you can read that object, mm-hmm. how much you can engage with that object. Mm-hmm. If you can look at it as a product of a particular society, as a response to a particular philosophical or political or social challenge, mm-hmm. then that object becomes so much more relevant and interesting for us. Mm-hmm. You know, for instance, for us in India, religion informs our sensibilities in so many ways, spirituality, mm-hmm. religion, mm-hmm. some idea like, I am an Indian. Mm-hmm. What makes you Indian? Mm-hmm. What is informing your Indian identity? What is mm-hmm. informing your Goan identity? Mm-hmm. And you're constantly thinking back, mm-hmm. I am Goan because I eat this food. Mm-hmm. Where did that food come from? Mm-hmm. What's the history of mm-hmm. it? I feel like this because my ancestors did this. Mm-hmm. This idea of a civilization's memory mm-hmm. is very well captured by yeah. our ancient art and artifacts.
Yeah, I remember actually a wonderful statement by Ashok Vajpayee. This is a dog is running around. He knows a few beaches around. He knows a few dogs in that area. But that dog has no idea that a dog existed in the 2nd century BC. Only human beings. We connect. So art, ancient art, is also kind of a vehicle of history.
It is. It's one of the most important vehicles we have. In mm-hmm. fact, a large part of our history mm-hmm. is visually communicated to us. Mm-hmm. You know, you say, yeah, I'm an Indian. I come from the land of the Taj Mahal.
Yes.
I am an Indian. I come from where there is the great temples of Khajuraho, the great mm-hmm. stupa at Sanchi, and so mm-hmm. on. I know that because it is part of my identity of who I am. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that has been informed by the visual records mm-hmm. of our memories, of our past.
Mm-hmm. Well, unfortunately, I find that most of the museums in this country mm-hmm. are very badly kept. We have a museum in Goa. Well, it was constructed actually recently. But the museum has things which are displayed very, very badly. Goa has had sort of a very special history, different from the rest of the country. So, what do you think is the state of the museums in this country?
The state of the museums in this country now somehow has to be changed. Mm-hmm. And they are having to change. Mm-hmm. They are making an effort at changing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we need to support them to make sure that that change happens. Mm-hmm. We are at a very important juncture in India. We have the most rapid urbanization taking place ever
mm-hmm.
in the history of the world.
Mm-hmm.
More and more people are leaving their villages and leaving their village ceremonies, temples, rituals,
mm-hmm.
those environments, and coming to live in a city.
Mm-hmm.
Where are you going to do your Rangoli in the city? Where mm-hmm. are you going to go and behave with a, participate in a community
mm-hmm.
like the way you did in the village?
Mm-hmm.
Those rituals, those contexts are getting lost very
mm-hmm.
fast.
Mm-hmm.
New cities are being made all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
What's astonishing is that museums are not being built in those cities.
Mm-hmm.
Urban planning is taking place all over the country, and fantastic SEZs are coming up, and mm-hmm. wonderful housing complexes are coming up, mm-hmm. which will get the vote bank in. Everyone will live in their two-bedroom hall, kitchen,
mm-hmm.
apartment mm-hmm. all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
But where is the space to engage with something outside your television?
Mm-hmm.
Because that's all you will be given as the form of entertainment and as the form of education in mm-hmm. your premises.
Mm-hmm.
It will be all because of electronic communication.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens to the heritage and the material culture of mm-hmm. our past?
Mm-hmm.
Where do we keep that? How do we house that? Where do we mm-hmm. look after it?
Mm-hmm.
And how do people make it relevant for people today?
Mm-hmm.
These are serious things that affect us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a temple will not keep khandit murtis.
Mm-hmm.
They are inauspicious.
Yeah.
So, where do the khandit murtis go?
Mm-hmm.
They are really relevant for mm-hmm. a telling of history.
Yeah.
Where do we put those objects? And how do we make them relevant for people to engage with?
Mm-hmm.
Art students engaging with it is one story.
Mm-hmm.
But there are other people, you go anywhere in the world, the first thing you do is go to that city and go and check out its museum. Why do we, nobody in India seems to want to check out the museums, because everyone's given up hope on the museums in
mm-hmm.
India. It's boring.
Yeah.
You have to march in one line as a school child,
mm-hmm.
go through those museums and be thrown back out of those mm-hmm. museums. It's the most boring outing you can have.
Yeah.
And if education is not turned into something much more engaging,
mm-hmm.
that is relevant,
mm-hmm.
it won't work.
Yeah, in Goa, for example, tourism is given a lot of impetus. Anywhere in the world you go, the first thing on the itinerary are the museums and the galleries. You go to Paris, you have to go to Louvre, you have to go to Pompidou Center, you have to go to Rodin Museum, Picasso Museum. But somehow, as far as tourism in Goa is concerned, we don't have anything which is man-made. We have invited people to look at our beaches, of course, the good food, drink, but museums-wise, we have nothing.
Well, it's sad because so much of Goa's mm-hmm. identity
yeah.
can be showcased so beautifully
mm-hmm.
in the museums of Goa.
Yeah.
Whatever little exists,
mm-hmm.
What I've seen,
yeah.
the museums are so rich.
Yeah.
They've got so many wonderful things
mm-hmm.
in them. And it really, they deserve to be made more alive and engaging
mm-hmm.
with people
mm-hmm.
And different kinds of communities.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you another thing, you know, people
yeah.
seem to say that in order to be able to reach out to the common man and to the general public, things
mm-hmm.
have to be made as if they are dumbed down.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to engage with very high ideas.
Mm-hmm.
That's nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
I think every man is a really intelligent person
mm-hmm.
who wants to not be treated like a fool.
Mm-hmm.
By making something simple, you're often turning it into something exceptionally boring.
Mm-hmm.
And people are willing to engage with extremely sophisticated ideas. You just have to communicate it in an
mm-hmm.
ordinary language.
Absolutely.
Rather than using
yes.
bad language. Using very complicated language is a sign of bad language.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can communicate complex ideas with simplicity,
mm-hmm.
and if you can communicate them beautifully, that's
mm-hmm.
what the museum is meant to do,
mm-hmm.
then you have something running where
mm-hmm.
people will actually participate and make a change.
Mm-hmm.
I found that when I took the Body in Indian Art exhibition to the Palais des Beaux-Arts in
mm-hmm.
Brussels,
mm-hmm.
I had 100,000 visitors in Brussels for the exhibition.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's an extraordinarily large number
yeah.
Of people who were willing to engage with gender politics,
mm-hmm.
regional politics of
mm-hmm.
the body,
mm-hmm.
Issues of sexuality,
mm-hmm.
all within a story of looking at existential universal questions.
Mm-hmm.
How does Indian civilization think about death? How mm-hmm. does, what are the many ways in which Indian civilization deals with birth or rebirth?
Mm-hmm.
You would imagine these kinds of questions are high philosophy questions.
Mm-hmm.
They are.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that the ordinary man doesn't think about high philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
100,000 visitors in Belgium
mm-hmm.
and nearly 60,000 visitors, I'm told, but mm-hmm. the latest figures are mm-hmm. awaited here in
mm-hmm.
Delhi.
Mm-hmm.
It really makes you realize that mm-hmm. there is a huge population that is willing to buy mm-hmm. tickets
mm-hmm.
and go to the museum that is not just the level of the upper middle classes
mm-hmm.
of educated
mm-hmm.
higher echelons of Indian mm-hmm. society,
mm-hmm.
but literally anyone and everyone off the street.
Mm-hmm.
That figure disturbed me a little bit. 100,000 visitors in Belgium
mm-hmm.
and 60,000 in Delhi. Mm-hmm. Once I was invited in Norway for doing some exhibition, I asked them, they said it's a big exhibition, big event, how many people will come? And they said about 500. Population of Norway is, I think, about 2 to 3 million. With such great population here in India, only 60,000 people in Delhi saw your exhibition.
Mm.
And a tiny country like Belgium, which
yes.
you can fully go yes. in one day everywhere, a lack of people came.
Mm.
Now, why?
Well, there are several factors for this.
Mm.
We are not a museum-going people.
Mm-hmm.
We are a temple-going people.
Mm-hmm.
We are a church-going people,
mm-hmm.
mosque-going people.
Mm-hmm.
How do you make people engage with something outside of religion?
Mm-hmm.
How do you make people not want to go to the mall, but
mm-hmm.
come to the museum?
Mm-hmm.
How do you want to make people not watch television
mm-hmm.
and come to the museum?
Mm-hmm.
How does the museum become something engaging and relevant to
mm-hmm.
people?
Because mm-hmm.
what we are competing with is
mm-hmm.
religion.
Mm-hmm.
What we are competing with is television
mm-hmm.
and shopping
mm-hmm.
and food.
Okay.
I think those are the industries that are the maximum consumers in this country.
Mm-hmm.
I think we are also reaching a point of absolute saturation.
Mm-hmm.
I think the mall becomes boring after a little while for
mm-hmm.
anyone.
Okay.
I think the desire for tasting new foods and spending money and
mm-hmm.
going out also
mm-hmm.
starts wearing thin.
Mm-hmm.
If the museum does not capitalize
mm-hmm.
on an audience that is waiting for it
mm-hmm.
and to do it well,
mm-hmm.
television in any case has failed us.
Mm-hmm.
Television has become something so anodyne and ridiculous and stupid
yeah.
most of the time
mm-hmm.
that none of us really want to spend time watching it
mm-hmm.
Or can't sustain ourselves
mm-hmm.
on it for very long.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the museum really has
mm-hmm.
a space
mm-hmm.
that it can fill.
Mm-hmm.
The point is that do we have the expertise
mm-hmm.
and the knowledge systems to be able to run those places in the way that need
mm-hmm.
to be run?
Mm-hmm.
Because running a museum is no joke.
Mm-hmm.